We welcome you to St. Matthew's United Methodist Church today. For those of you that are here, and for those of you that are going to watch it online tonight. The World Day of Prayer is being held today in 146 countries in our world. And it started back in the mid-1940s, and it's an international, interchurch organized organization that's led by women, which enables us to know and to hear the thoughts of women from all parts of the world, their hopes, their concerns, and their prayers. An international committee is based in New York, and it reviews applications from different countries that want to participate, and they do this every 5 years, and then they choose five different countries. And so this year, of course, will be the Christian women of Palestine that are calling on us to pray for their war-torn country. They are calling us to connect with the land from where Jesus came, where he was born, where he was ministered, and where he died, and from where our faith began its deep roots. When they planned this prayer service, the ladies of Palestine had no idea how much ongoing conflict and uncertainty that their world and their place of country was taking place today. The women of Palestine share their love and they give hope to everyone here. The theme of 2024's service, Bear with One Another in Love, seems appropriate for these women who will not give up their witnessing the love of Jesus. Our prayer service today was written by the women of Palestine, and we adapted it to include many prayers for the country of Palestine. And we have some different, the beautiful Palestinian kaftan that we borrowed from Naima from Bowie, Maryland. And all the different articles on the altar are significant for Palestine. So we adapted it a little bit to show the art. And some of you saw that coming in. And this is all from the country of Palestine.
I'd like to say welcome to our 2024 World Day of Prayer worship service. Shalom, peace to all.
And also with you.
We gather in the name of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Loving God, walk with us as we journey through the land where you lived and taught. Open our eyes to see the present suffering of the inhabitants of this land. Grant us the strength and courage to act and pray with all who suffer around the world. Amen. Let us praise God, who brings us together to worship in love and unity.
Bring me far above our earthly differences and views and theology.
Help us remember these essential qualities of faith, humility, gentleness, patience, and love. We confess our weakness and failure to accept others without judging them. We endeavor to be humble and patient as we face challenges in our families, society, community, and church. With gentleness and love, we can overcome difficulties. We may remain strong in our faith, knowing that we belong to God. Amen.
Will you please join me in singing The Voice of God is Calling, number 336 in the hymnal? Oh, I mean 436, sorry.
Jody needs her cane, and I need a stool. We're in great shape up here. And this will be interesting, not because of what I have to say, but because I brought the wrong prescription glasses, and I didn't do large prints. Anyway, I'm here to talk to you a little bit about the symbols. And if you will, pull out your bulletin and take a look at the painting that's on the front of it. I'm going to talk a little bit about the symbols on the bulletin and the symbols that you see at the front of the church. In honor of the World Day of Prayer, the artwork on the cover of your bulletin was painted by Halima Aziz, a passionate Palestinian visual artist. Halima spent her childhood in Palestine. She experienced the 2008 war in Gaza and survived it. There are several Palestinian symbols depicted in both Halima's painting and at the front of the sanctuary. Taking a look at the artwork on your bulletin first, we see three Palestinian women praying together in nature in a peaceful place. The olive tree and the branches are a sign of everlasting and abundant life because they can live for thousands of years. Some of the olive trees in Palestine today were there during the time of Jesus. Olive branches are also displayed on either side of the altar. The golden roots at the bottom of the painting underline the fact that Palestinians will always exist, and as they exist, they will always resist for their rights and freedom. The roots are painted in gold because it is something precious, something that no one can take away from the Palestinians because they are rooted. The poppy flowers can be seen in the hair of the three women and on the altar. You can't miss them because they're bright red. Poppies are the national flower, and they are abundant and meaningful to Palestinians. They remind them of loved ones who have given their lives for their country. Another symbol is the traditional Palestinian dresses, such as the tatris, thobe, meaning embroidered dress, and the white scarf worn by the Palestinian women in the painting. The embroidery carries the stories, heritage, and essence of the Palestinian identity through its vibrant threads and patterns, showcasing the artistic brilliance of Palestinian women. The beauty is very evident in the Palestinian dress that you see at the front of the church. In the painting, you'll note that the woman in the middle has a key on a chain around her neck. There are also keys attached to the front of the fruit basket up on the altar. The keys are a symbol of the hope refugees have to return back to Palestine. Palestinians always carry the keys of their homes they were driven out of with them, no matter where they are around the world. They pass the keys on to their children so they will never lose hope. Some other Palestinian symbols displayed at the front of the sanctuary include the bird that's on the front. That's the Palestine sunbird, which is the national bird and a symbol of freedom and the vibrant biodiversity of Palestine. These agile and colorful birds represent the beauty and resilience of the nation's spirit and the freedom and spirit of survival. The fresh fruit in the basket is fruit that you would find growing in Palestine. And some of the fruit has special meaning. For example, watermelon slices are a subtle symbol of national identity in times where displaying the flag was not possible. People displayed the fruit with its colors, which mirror the exact colors of the Palestinian flag. The poppy is recognized as the national flower of Palestine. It symbolizes the resilience and enduring spirit of the Palestinian people. This designation stems from the flower's pervasive presence in the region and its poignant representation in various cultural and historical contexts. And as I mentioned earlier, they also have the same colors as the flag. The kafifia, I have a hard time pronouncing that, is a traditional headscarf that represents the warmth, resilience, and rooted cultural identity of the Palestinian people. The Palestinian cuisine is represented by the cookbook, next to which is a bottle of olive oil and a bowl of olives. Each traditional dish tells a tale, carrying the flavors of diverse regions, histories, and the innovative spirit of Palestinian culinary arts, representing communal unity and cultural richness. And last, you'll see there are some cacti up there. They represent the tough and enduring sobra cactus, which is found in Palestine. It symbolizes the resilience of the Palestinian spirit and thrives in adversity, symbolizing the people's capacity to withstand challenges and thrive. And following the service today, I'd like to welcome everybody up so that you can take a closer look of all the symbols of Palestine. And there are also tables out in the narthex, which has some items from Palestine, many of them some beautiful olive carvings that you'll really want to take a look at. They're beautiful.
Good afternoon. I'm reading from the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. I, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. God of all creation, bring justice and peace to our world. Teach us to be peacemakers. Guide us in our pursuit of justice and the common good. Inspire us to welcome all, forgive all, and love all. Direct us as we walk in the shadow of Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. Inspire us to perceive the world through your eyes, that we might find hope and joy each day, supportive of each other, for the sake of your kingdom. Amen. Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is a great pleasure to be here and to see all of you here today. It is my honor and my privilege to introduce our guest speaker today, who I happen to work with, so it's an awesome day to be here out of work with him. I'd like to let you all welcome Eli Salzman, who is the director of the Joseph and Alma Guildenhorn Institute of Israel Studies at the University of Maryland at College Park.
Oh, I forgot mine. I had to go back to the car, actually. Thank you so much for having me. My name is Eli Salzman. I'm a professor of visual studies and the director of the Guildenhorn Institute for Visual Studies, as Lisa just said. I teach classes that focus on Israeli foreign and security policy, Israeli politics and society, U.S. foreign policy in the Middle East, as well as a class on political psychology, Israel and Middle Eastern politics. I'll get back to that class particularly in a few minutes. But first, I'd like to thank Lisa Klein and everybody here for inviting me to speak with you today. It seems like this is a very meaningful and important day for you all, and so thank you so much for having me, making me part of that. I'm sure you know by now, but Lisa is not human, not in the conventional sense. She's truly a superwoman, as far as I'm concerned. I fondly call her Madame Niet, Mrs. No. Because as the Guildenhorn Institute's business manager, she makes sure we run the Institute's budget and finances responsibly and in compliance with the university's guidelines and policies. I cannot thank her enough for everything she has done for us, although this normally entails her classical response, quote unquote, no, this cannot be funded by the university. So hopefully after me giving this talk, we can finally get some coffee or napkins or something. In any case, I'm honored and delighted to be here today with you all. I'm a Talmudic or a Socratic teacher in that sense. I don't like giving talks in class. I prefer a conversation. So with your permission, we'll do it in that way. we'll try to figure out kind of how does it work for us and the people at home. I think it's more engaging, it's more dynamic, I think it's more enjoyable for both yourself and myself. I'll try to be brief with some opening remarks just to frame the whole conversations. And if you ever met a university professor, you know this is very challenging to keep it short. It's a very difficult task for us, if not impossible, and so we should be ready to open the floor for Q&A and a conversation at about 5 p.m. tomorrow. So I was reflecting extensively in a great deal about the prompt that Lisa provided me in the flyer. I have it printed somewhere else. I beg of you, bear with one another in love. And it sounded rather familiar to me, being Jewish, not Christian. It reminded me of a quote from the Old Testament, and again I quote, "You shall not take vengeance or bear grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord," Leviticus 19:17. And there's great resemblance, and I think you can all see the resemblance there between these two quotes. In the case of the Old Testament, I'm not a theologian, I don't do Christian or Jewish theology, but I think that you are ordered to love your neighbor, and the classical argument is that there's a punishment for violating this command. It is not physical, but rather spiritual or metaphysical, if you wish, and it will be enforced by God. The sages of the Mishnah and the Talmud, that is 3rd century BC through 6th century AD, grappled with the enforcement mechanism. How do you enforce something to that extent? How do you really know if somebody loves their neighbor? How do you gauge that? How do you measure that? Some argue this command is applicable only among Jews, for example. But others argue this applies to all human beings. So like many things in this text, one can find different interpretations or meanings, depending where you come from, how you read the text, if you'd like. But I think that there's a social aspect to this command. It is not about necessarily the religious side of it, although it's a religious text. There's a strong social dimension at play here. It's about accepting each other. It's about seeing each other. Or in other words, it is about humanizing each other, I would argue. The opposite of humanizing is dehumanizing, quite straightforward. I would like to focus on that today, if you don't mind. This is a phenomenon that I address in great detail both in my class on political psychology as well as my scholarship. I wrote about it extensively and focused on dehumanization during the 1930s in the Soviet Union, and the conclusions are quite straightforward. When one dehumanizes the other group, individual, whatever that is, and deprives them of their humanity, agency, based on their ethnicity, religion, political beliefs, or any other features, oftentimes a door is opened when you can do to them horrible and unimaginable things. The Jewish Holocaust is another example of major 20th century dehumanization project, so to speak, a disastrous phenomenon, absolutely. But we can also mention the Balkan Wars in the 1990s, the conflict in Yugoslavia, as well as the Rwandan genocide in the 1990s. Again, cases of dehumanization. So when we engage each other without love, then the result is kind of grudges, resentment, hate, fear, dislike. Engaging each other with love, on the other hand, is completely different. It is a more accepting and validating approach towards other people. But how can we achieve that? How do you make this actionable? So I went online and I found a couple of suggestions. First, you practice humility. It's about knowing your limits, your weaknesses, and so on and so forth when you approach each other. Second, we need to have gentleness. It's the idea that you don't have to be rough and rugged all the time. You can show compassion, you can be kind to others. And last but not least, you need to have patience as well as tolerance, which is the idea of self-restraint. We may not agree about everything, but we should coexist. We should live one next to the other at the same time. I can certainly address the origins of the current conflict because this day of prayer was probably planned ahead of time. It didn't happen on October 6th or 7th or 8th. During the Q&A section, perhaps, But I can tell you for sure that there's very little love to go around nowadays in that part of the world. There's a lack of humanity, there's a lack of humility, there's no gentleness there, and there's certainly no self-restraint. Let me be clear about that, and we're on the record in a way. There's plenty of blame to go around. I'm not gonna start pointing fingers. I think it's kind of productive, but we can certainly try to address and kind of unpack that. There's lots of culprits with varying degrees of responsibility for the situation on the ground. I was always a practical and pragmatic individual. I was involved in Israeli-Palestinian efforts for coexistence as an undergrad and then as a graduate student. So with your permission, I'd like to address the questions of how to get out of this exceptionally dark place in Middle Eastern history or politics. And say the following. I'm a political scientist, more particularly I'm an international relations scholar, and I'd like to suggest a three-level answer to this question. How do we go from A to B? How do we go from this dark place to something, somewhere that is much more positive and reassuring? So on the international and regional level, there needs to be a concerted effort to bring this conflict to a halt as quickly as possible. This means releasing all the hostages, about 135, including a one-year-old baby who was there for the past 4.5 months, in return for Palestinians and Israeli prisoners. It seems pretty sensible. It looks pretty practical and easy to do. It also means making sure there is no robust international presence in the Gaza Strip, multinational peacekeeping forces, for example, and a true commitment to rehabilitate and rebuild the Gaza Strip for the inhabitants on the ground. About 70% of the infrastructure was destroyed following the Israeli incursion into the Gaza Strip, and it's still ongoing. Certainly it's gonna increase if they do move on to Rafah in the south. There needs to be a broader effort to establish Israeli peace. It will not be easy, but I believe that the creation of a Palestinian state side by side Israel will allow the Israelis to maintain their Jewish and democratic foundations of the principles of the state of Israel, while an independent Palestinian state will allow the Palestinians to experience self-determination, sovereignty, and the legitimacy that they so desperately need and are entitled to. On the domestic level, there needs to be a new generation of leadership, both on the Palestinian and the Israeli side. I think the two peoples are desperate for and entitled to leaders who can focus on hope and not fear. Leaders who can work to fulfill the common good and not their personal or political interests. It is quite common to see Israelis and Arabs say that if there were no politicians involved, the Middle East would be completely different, would look dramatically different. Different, I mean, better, of course. On the individual level, I think that both Israelis and Palestinians must engage in a deep and meaningful self-reflection. Think about who they are, what they have become, and who they wish to be. This may sound like a motivational catchphrase, but I truly believe that all of us, need to think about the best person they can be, both for myself and for others. It's about seeing each other, as I said, in a different light, humanizing the other person and understanding where they are coming from. Being sensitive and empathetic to the pain and loss of the other writ large, and combine it with some actionable ways to make a better day tomorrow for everybody. I know that this sounds overly optimistic or naive, but as I told a colleague the other day, I'm keeping my fingers crossed that from the current tragedy, which is truly horrible for both Palestinians and Israelis, a reckoning will emerge. Both sides are deeply enclosed in their collective traumas, and I hope that they see this ongoing tragedy, not at the end as the end of the road, but rather as a beginning of a conversation, something that will lead to a more hospitable environment, something more constructive and positive for both of them. Jews in Israel are afraid. They feel existentially threatened. They've been traumatized on October 7th. Strategically, or kind of historically speaking, Israelis want to be accepted, they want to be validated, they want to be acknowledged by their neighbors. Palestinians, on the other hand, seek also recognition of their suffering too and their history. They want to provide for their children and wish to live free from Israeli control or occupation, which are all natural, logical, human things to wish for. There are momentous obstacles, obviously, and there are plenty of spoilers on both sides, on all sides, who are eager to derail these prospects for a better tomorrow. I do want to say, hold on just a second, I'm missing this piece of paper that did not print. I had a wonderful quote from Roosevelt about the value of love that will always be stronger than the value of hate, which brings me back to this day of prayer and say that if we do bear with one another in love, we can bring about a better tomorrow, much more positive future for us and for our children, not only in the United States, not only in the Middle East, but around the world. Again, perhaps naive, but I prefer to be naive rather than just give up. Thank you so much. And as I said, sorry, Lisa, I'm going to keep you sitting for another second. Rather than me continue talking and frying your brains for another 50 minutes or 50 hours, which I can do quite easily, I think that our conversation is much more interesting. Yeah? Is that okay?
Yes.
Go for it.
Fine. Go for it.
That's it? That's the end of the conversation. Please. Absolutely. Thank you so much for the comment. And again, I really appreciate that. I think that this is exactly why I didn't want to go on and kind of engage in this ongoing lecture. So I'll say two things in response, in a way, following your comments. One biographical, the other one something perhaps more academic, scholarly, wonky, so to speak. I was involved with an Israeli nonprofit at the time. It was called the Young Israel Forum for Cooperation. I was young. One day, many, many, many moons ago, many, many decades ago. And our idea was to bring Israelis, Palestinians, and Europeans, because Israelis and Palestinians didn't manage that well together, and so we needed kind of a buffer, somebody in between. And it was easier to fly to Europe and bring Israelis and Palestinians there than to be somewhere in the West Bank or somewhere else. And the argument was that if you meet each other, if you see each other, you can humanize the other, exactly as you said. These were very short, intensive seminars in Europe, and they were effective to the extent that the people who left the seminar after 10 days or 2 weeks, they became good friends. The problem was the sustainability or the scaling of that project. How do you bring all the Israelis and all the Palestinians at the same time to a couple of weeks in Greece, for example? That was the main challenge. And so I'm going to transition to the wonky part, the academic part. This is called people-to-people conflict resolution, this idea that once you meet people, you know that Lisa is not as bad as Madame Niet might be oftentimes, and we can be friends. I'm going to push that line a couple of more times today as well, so be cautious. But once, for example, the second Intifada erupted in early 2000s, then people went back to their respective tribes, so to speak. And so no longer the memories of the seminar in Europe was able to sustain the shocks. It was, the reality was too difficult, too harsh for them to sustain. So there's it needs to be kind of a multi-level effort, so it's bottom up and top down. As I said, I'm a big believer in leadership. I think that there's a desperate need for a change in leadership all across the region to have new ideas, younger, again, I'm not as young as I was, but certainly younger folks who can engage, can infuse this conversation with new ideas, with new energies, outside the box thinking, critical thinking, and so on and so forth. But there's also a need to kind of to re-engage people-to-people activities, to make people more aware of what's going on. I can tell you from an Israeli perspective, we have a conference on March 12 about the coverage or the treatment of the media of the conflict. And from the Israeli perspective, there's very little coverage of what is happening in Gaza, certainly not to the extent you see it here in the United States, or certainly in Arabic-speaking TV channels like Al Jazeera and Al Arabiya and the others. The Israelis are, and I spoke about that with a colleague just yesterday, they have a very limited bandwidth given the trauma that they sustain. They are in a state where they are unable to accommodate the suffering of the other. Really, this is the tragedy. And so my colleague used to say, but don't they care about the 30,000 people killed? I said, they don't have the time or the patience or the energy to engage in that. They are still mourning, still processing the trauma of October 7th. That is ongoing in a number of ways. And I assume that the Palestinians kind of experience the same thing as well. The invasion, the incursion, the destruction, the relocation, the displacement, and so on and so forth. It is tragic. And if there's something kind of that is disheartening about the Middle East is that it can always get worse quite quickly, quite quickly. My wife and I went to bed midnight Friday night here in Rockville. We saw that there were some rockets fired. It was about 6:15, 6:30 a.m. in Israel. I said, well, it's more of the same. Let's go to bed. Everything is fine. The families are fine. We woke up 7 hours later into a totally different environment. Totally different universe, so to speak. The Israelis then, later on the Palestinians. And I'm not equating, I'm not creating a balance of who suffers more in that sense. So yes, knowing more, knowing each other, humanizing the other, it is very difficult to do that now. Very difficult, but inevitable. Please.
I was kind of wondering about Hamas,
yeah,
and the relationship of the Palestinian people to Hamas, how Hamas stays in power when clearly it's not working. So could you address that a little bit, how they took power and retained it?
Yeah. It's interesting. Wednesday's class in my Israeli foreign security policy focused on the first Lebanon War, 1982. And it starts with an argument that this kind of brought about kind of the reemergence of the Palestinian question. Monday's meeting is about the first Intifada, the first Palestinian uprising in 1987. Hamas is an extreme Islamist group, militant extremist Islamist group. It was, whether we like it or not, it was supported by the Israelis during the first Intifada as a way to counterbalance the PLO's influence on the ground. Careful what you wish for, in a way. It had taken, once Israel, this is kind of a short history of the conflict in a way, part of it, Hamas. Once Israel unilaterally disengaged from the Gaza Strip in the summer of 2005, the Palestinian Authority remained there, and Hamas, becoming stronger, were pretty much in feud, so we can talk about intra-Palestinian strife or intra-Palestinian competition for power and influence. In 2006, elections takes place. Mahmoud Abbas or Abu Mazen is appointed or elected president of the Palestinian Authority, the Palestinian Legislative Council. Elections result in a massive majority of Hamas at the time. They feel that they don't have a sufficient voice in the conversation, the intra-Palestinian conversation, and within a few months they overthrow the rule of the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank, in the Gaza Strip, my apologies. And this is where you go to this situation. The Israelis impose a siege, Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Olmert imposes a siege. The Quartet, that is an international kind of arrangement of the United States, the United Nations, the Russians, and the Europeans, kind of put forward a couple of conditions to Hamas in order to legitimize them as a political entity to negotiate with. One of which was recognize or acknowledge the existence of the State of Israel, as the PLO did in the late 1980s and early 1990s, as well as denounce the use of violence and terrorism as a way to achieve political goals. Hamas refused, in a sense, and so the siege continued to this very day. So when we talk about the situation in Gaza, or the siege over Gaza, this is part of that. Again, Hamas is a non-democratic entity, has no interest in democracy or democratization in that sense. Oh, absolutely, we'll continue afterwards. Are we done? Oh, my apologies, okay. Well, so we'll have the conversation later. My apologies, absolutely. Thank you so much for having me. Cheers.
Thank you for your words, Eli. Lord God, we turn to you in these trying hours when conflict is a daily reality for our sisters and brothers in Israel and Palestine. We promise you to work and to our utmost for peace and reconciliation in the region. But we know we cannot do it alone. We very much need the strength of your presence in our midst if we are to overcome the obstacles before us. So our prayer at this moment is that you add your support to our efforts, that you show yourself as a tower of strength in these moments when the barriers seem impossible. Together, we can become beacons of hope for justice and peaceful societies in the land so very dear to the peoples of your covenant. Amen.
O God, may we commit to the working for peace as we stand with all women, particularly those experiencing oppression, violence, or discrimination. May we be the faithful advocates in all levels of society and church life. May we bear with one another in love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Since today is the World Day of Prayer, I'm inviting you to come to the altar and pray your prayer for the people in Palestine, or you can kneel at the altar, or you can stay in your seat. So this is a time for all of us to pray for peace in Palestine.
Let us bow our heads and pray together. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we now pray for women everywhere, for the world, and for those in need. Let us pray. God of righteousness, bless us and make us witnesses of peace and justice. Open our eyes so that we can see things as you do. Protect us from all forms of violence, hurt, and revenge. We pray especially for women who are denied education and other basic rights, for women who are abused and suffer violence. We pray that our churches, as well as our governments, will create safe places for women. Help us to raise our voices and use our gifts and talents to help others. Lead us into a life worthy of our calling. Hear our prayer. Refugee God, because your son Jesus as a child had to flee a massacre in Bethlehem, you know the plight of refugees and the displaced. Remain with them and help them in these dark and difficult times. Guide and protect them and bring them to places of safety. Open the hearts of those receiving refugees and guide the actions of political leaders so that all needs will be met. Lead us into a life worthy of our calling. Hear our prayer. God, our rock, you have taught us to build our lives on you. We pray for those who are homeless and especially for families whose homes have been destroyed through war or natural disasters. We pray for all who work tirelessly to resolve these situations. Lead us into a life worthy of our calling. Hear our prayer. God of peace, we pray for peaceful end to the ongoing situation in Palestine. We also pray for the city of Jerusalem, sacred to the three religions of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. Let there be equality, freedom of religion, freedom of movement, and freedom of expression. Teach us as Christians to follow the way of Jesus, sharing love with those we meet. Lead us into a life worthy of our calling. Hear our prayer. God of unity, your son Jesus prayed that your disciples and followers would be one as you are one. Teach us, your servants, to treat others justly, fairly, and with love, even though we may speak, live, and pray differently. Bless the global church and bless the faithful women everywhere who share your good news with others. Lead us into a life worthy of our calling. Hear our prayer. Let us join together in reciting the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join in the singing of hymn 437. This is my song.
Thank you.
may be seated. There's a basket at the back of our sanctuary, and our World Day of Prayer offering is collected, and it includes two projects in Palestine. The first is the Department of Service to Palestinian Refugees, ministering to women living on the West Bank. The project focuses on helping women to enter the job force, those that they receive money to meet their needs and those within their families. The second is the Bible Society, the Child of the Bethlehem Project. Out of the population of 5.4 million living on the West Bank and Gaza, one third are aged 15 or younger, and only 1% are Christians. The Bible Society is searching and reaching this age group by offering Bible camps and distributing Bibles. Over the past few years, over 50,000 Bibles and scriptures have been distributed. You'll find an offering basket and also some information if you would like to write a check or another way. And I'd like to thank everyone that came today and those of you that are on Facebook. And I'd like to thank all the participants and everyone that came. And a special to our speaker, Eli, for coming today. And you see the beautiful Palestinian caftan that's here in our sanctuary and some other things out on the table. And they're from Naimi, who is a resident of Bowie, Naimi Ben Aladdin Samin, and she is starting a Palestinian caftan business, and she gave us these things to borrow, paintings and the tatris embroidery. So please see that. And we thank all the people that gave us art and the beautiful olive wood carvings for our World Day of Prayer today. So I'd ask our pastor, Reverend J.W. Park, to do our benediction.
Would you all stand for the blessings, if you're able? Receive your benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Now go in peace. Amen.
Amen.